The pain, the anxiety, the frustration can awfully seem overwhelming. Sometimes we feel like the whole world is laughing at us. But there is victory. There's victory that comes from knowing that we can be fully persuaded. The pain, the anxiety, the frustration can often seem so overwhelming. But we can be more than conquerors. We don't have to see ourselves just as victims, but victors. And we see it in the Word of God. It's so clear in 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5. It says, "This is the victory that overcomes the world. Who overcomes the world? Only he or she who believes that Jesus is the Son of God." This involves knowing that Christ is in control. And we need to be fully persuaded. And God's Word shows us how we can do that. Let's go to Him right now in prayer. Father God, I come to You with my brothers, my sisters, and I'm asking You to just move in our lives in a very special way. Help us not to waver between two opinions, but to be fully persuaded that You are there in this great time of need. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Elijah, when he was before the children of Israel, said, "Choose ye this day the God you're going to serve." He says, don't waver between two opinions. If Baal is God, serve him. If God is God, worship him. Joshua said something earlier when he says, "Choose ye this day the God you serve, but as for me and my family, we shall serve the living God." Joshua was fully persuaded. Elijah was fully persuaded, and he stood before the prophets of Baal, Elijah did, and he believed God to the extent that God had fire fall from heaven and consume his altar, his sacrifice, while the prophets of Baal got nowhere. Abraham was called to have a son when he's 90 years old. Moses to lead the children of Israel to the promised land when he's 80 years old. But we're told in God's Word in Romans chapter 4, verse 21, that Abraham was fully persuaded that God had the power to do what he had promised. When you and I become fully persuaded, we can know beyond a shadow of doubt that truly God is able to do what he's told us in the scriptures. Now, let's back up for a little bit. Jesus implied that if we weren't fully persuaded, that if we did not know God, we'd be worrying all the time. And he had a lot to say about worry. Worry is actually like a rocking chair where you go back and forth, back and forth, but you're really not going anywhere. You worry. Worry about what people think about you. Worry about whether the bills will be paid. Worry about whether God's going to take care of you. And perhaps you're familiar with this verse, but let's take a deeper look at it. And maybe we'll get some more insight into it. He says, "Therefore, I tell you, don't worry about your life." He says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, "Don't worry about your life, what you shall eat or what you're going to drink or about your body, what you'll wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not a more valued than they? And of any of you, can you add a single hour to your span of life? Why do you worry?" Again, worry just going back and forth, but never really getting anywhere. Why worry? He says, your daddy's going to take care of you. The birds believe that their father, they're going to take care of them. Don't you have as much faith as a bird? Don't you know your daddy's going to provide for you? Now, the birds, they don't just sit there with their mouth open waiting for God to drop a worm in them. They get up and they go out and look for the worms, but they know he's got one out there for them. And every day, they just start out the day by just singing and praising God. Why is it that we can't believe God to the extent that the birds do? This comes from being fully persuaded that God is able to do what he had promised. And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothed the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown in the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, don't worry, saying, what will we eat or what will we drink or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things. Indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all of them. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. So don't worry, he says. Don't worry about tomorrow. Actually, this constant worry and not being fully persuaded that God is able to do what he has promised cause us to be crucified daily on a cross of worry, with one thief being yesterday over all the things that happened yesterday we could worry about today, and the other thief being tomorrow. Well, what's going to happen? And so there we are, we're hanging on that cross just between those two thieves that are robbing us of all the joy that God fully intended for us to experience. It's often easy for us to worry about what other people are thinking about us. It's often easy for us to evaluate ourselves in comparison to other people. We live in a world that looks down on the poor, the fatherless, the widow, the hurting, the homeless. Tragically enough, some people laugh at the plight of other people because they're not secure in their own life. They're not fully persuaded that God has everything all under control. We continue to journey into the scriptures, seeing what he'd have to say to us at this particular hour. But we first of all stop back for a moment. Let's realize that as 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, that if anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. And that's his promise to us. And that's what he's saying to us at this particular moment. If anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed and the new has come. And then Paul goes on and says now, and because you're a new creation in Colossians 2, 6, and 7, he makes it clear. So then if you've received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith that you were taught, and overflowing with thanksgiving. Wow, what a mighty God we serve. If anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. We know all this stuff up here, but being fully persuaded that God is able to do what he has promised suddenly liberates us. We're able to just lay it down before the Lord. A very decisive moment in the life of Billy Graham was when he was a young man and he laid out in the woods the Bible on a stump. And he declared, God, today I'm going to take this as your word and I'm going to live according to it. And he was able to preach with the power and authority that brought millions to Christ. Instead of wavering between two opinions, let's let the Holy Spirit work in our lives. Let's pray for the Holy Spirit to work in our lives. And let's believe that God will indeed do what he has promised. Let's be truly, fully persuaded. Because many aren't fully persuaded. They're not able to see the glory and the power of the resurrected Christ. They're not able to see him to the fullness. In fact, as we take a look here at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, it says, their minds have been blinded. They're actually unbelievers. The God of this world has blinded the eyes of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of God, who's the image of God. And there's the world, the secular humanistic world that we live in. It's constantly trying to blind us, trying to confuse us, trying to keep us from being fully persuaded that God is able to do what he has promised. He tells us in verse 6 here, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, let light, for God, he said, let light shine out of darkness, has shone in our hearts to give the light of his knowledge of the glory of God in Christ Jesus. Fully persuaded, but we have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be clear that the extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. So we're fully persuaded. We're saying, Lord, I'm believing you to do this thing and do it now. It doesn't happen now. So there's the enemy right there saying, see, God ain't going to be it. I didn't even know he's around. All that kind of stuff that just keeps you from just standing firm on God's word. Are you fully persuaded? Well, the first thing to do when you get fully persuaded is to know what God's will is. Put first the kingdom of God, all these things shall be added unto you. It's clear according to his word that he wants all men and women to be saved and come in the knowledge of truth. You got an unsaved loved one, pray for them, be fully persuaded, and know that through the power of God, as you trust in him, they'll be brought into the kingdom of God. What a mighty God we serve. So we do not lose heart, we read in verse 16. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary afflictions is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, because we look not at what can be seen, but what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, what cannot be seen is eternal. So that's what we're looking at this moment. So if we see ourselves as individuals created in the image of God and fully persuaded that God has everything under control, we don't have to worry so much about what other people think about us. We don't have to constantly wondering if they're talking about us, if they're laughing about us, what they're doing. We don't have to continue to fall in the pits of depression. In fact, when we find ourselves slipping into such because we're afraid that this person's saying that or another person saying that, we can do what they did to overcome Satan. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of testimony. We see in Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. So Satan's coming at us saying these people are making fun of you. They're laughing at you. Devil, you're a liar. Jesus is Lord. At the same time, in our hearts and minds, we can be fully persuaded that God loves all our brothers and sisters, regardless of who they might be. And we can put people over prophets, and we can become the people that God has called us to be at this particular hour. It all involves being fully persuaded that God is in control and that His Word is true. And as we stand on the Word of God, we're able to watch Him do exceedingly beyond what we begin to ask and think. We're able to trust Him at this particular moment. So again, being fully persuaded totally radicalizes everything we approach in life. And the way we do approach life, our worldview begins to change, being fully persuaded that God is able to do what He has promised. Instead of worrying constantly about this, that, and the other, what people are saying, what people are doing, we are able to be anchored in God's Word. Not worrying about if people may be laughing at us because we're standing on the Word of God or moving forward in His direction. And at the same time, it changes our perspective towards other people. Instead of looking at people that may not that have the abilities we think they should have or people that are down and out, God fills our hearts with a new compassion and gives us the love of Christ. And we're able to move into the lives of the hurting and the homeless and watching Him do exceedingly beyond we can even ask or think. That's the challenge that exists before us at this particular time. Let's let His light and love flow through us, finding ourselves solid on the Word of God, knowing that He is a great God and a mighty God, and not being so worried about what everybody thinks about us, and being free in our spirit, where we can reach out to those that Jesus identified with, the fatherless, the widowed, the hurting, and the homeless.
On my teeth, and I know how it feels to cry myself to sleep. I'm that kid on every playground who's always chosen last, single teenage mother trying to overcome my past.
You don't have to be my friend, but is it too much?
Thank you.
tight. We're all the same.
Someday we'll all have perfect wings.
Don't let that mean.
Don't let that mean. Don't call me names. Don't get your pleasure from my pain.
In God's eyes, we're all the same.
When I first heard this song, I was touched, yes, literally touched by the fact that it's so real, because there's so many people in life today that are laughing at one another, are so afraid that they're being laughed at. Social media has become so powerful in the lives of so many individuals. They're constantly worried about, what's this person saying about me, or that person saying that. Some of the cruelest things are said on such social media. We have to see it. Each person, including yourself and those around you, are made in the image of God. Are you fully persuaded over that particular fact? Now, if there's something that's very troubling in your life, rather than just continuing to let the enemy just cause it to eat away at you, know in your heart that God hears you and God answers prayer. Be fully persuaded over that fact. Let me share with you just a few things about prayer. Prayer, of course, involves communication with God. Prayer thrusts us into the theater of God's kingdom, opening our hearts and minds to all that He has created, all that He's placed around us, taking God's word and combining it with the wonders and the works of His creation, fully persuaded that God is able to do what He has promised, thrusts us into a whole new reality. It opens up before us possibilities that we've never experienced before. It gives us opportunities that we thought were never possible. Jesus tells us that in those moments when we're having a hard time, perhaps being fully persuaded over a fact, and the enemy's right there just trying to cause us to doubt, perhaps when we may be sick, our loved one is sick, and it's just so hard for us to just release our faith. He says, gather together, call some other people to pray with you. Whatever two or three agree here on earth, it's agreed upon in heaven, is what he says. Prayer is so powerful. Prayer from a life that's fully persuaded is not just talking to God with our mouths. It's enabling us, Lord, to open up the total aspects of who we are and what we are. And we're able to see God in a very special, powerful way as we move into the wonders of His creation. Say, I refer to it frequently as a prayer walk in the woods or in the park. Or it can be down a busy street as you begin to see God in each person that passes you. As you begin to see God in the squirrels that are scampering along, or the rabbits, or the other day when I was out, the geese beside a lake. It's so exciting to see God, to hear God in a very special way, to be able to just taste the wonders of His creation, to feel the breeze, to smell the scent of the flowers, to pray with all of our senses, moving us into the dimension of the fact that we are fully persuaded that God is there. He hears us, and He's going to respond to our prayers. And, you know, a powerful prayer, being fully persuaded, is as much listening as it is speaking. Lord, what are you trying to show me at this particular time? Picking up the Word of God, letting Him speak to us through His Word, such as we referred to earlier, as we're out there, as we see the birds. They don't worry, you know, and yet your Heavenly Father takes care of them. Or the flowers, they don't toil or spin, and look at the beauty that they're in. We're fully persuaded in the same way that God takes care of His creation, even so He'll meet the need that we're facing at this particular time. Fully persuaded that God is able to do what He has promised. Back to the book of Romans, where we were told that Abraham was fully persuaded. Look at that. Abraham is promised that he's going to be a father of a great nation. And when he dies, the only piece of ground he owns actually, it's the plot of ground, the cave that he's buried in. And he's going to be a father of a great nation with so many children. And all he has is Isaac, Ishmael at that particular time. Isaac and Ishmael, and Isaac's the one that the promise is coming through at this particular moment. God is a great God. He's a mighty God. And Abraham was fully persuaded. Fully persuaded. I made reference to other sons of Abraham. But when you go to the scriptures, see after Sarah died, and new wife Keturah, and he had additional sons. The anointing that came upon him when he had Isaac continued to be in his life, even into old age. He was fully persuaded. But he didn't have lots and lots of children, as many as the stars of the sky when he died. He believed God and died by faith, knowing that God was going to bring forth a great nation from him. Our lives will be totally changed when we move along through life and we're asking God for something and we don't see it immediately. And there's the enemy telling us that it's not going to happen, and you can say, devil, you're a liar. I'm fully persuaded that God is here and God will answer prayer. I'm fully persuaded that he'll provide me the victory that I need at this particular time over the disease and over the greed and over the oppression and the injustice and death. I believe, Lord God, that not even death can kill the vision within me. For through death, I'll be entering into your presence, because I'm fully persuaded that Jesus Christ, when he died on the cross, he paid the full price for my sins. In the same way that Jesus rose from the dead, I shall also be resurrected. For truly, he's a mighty God. He says, come unto me, all you labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. I will give you rest. And he says, I'll give you rest in the midst of those circumstances, in the midst of those trials, in the midst of those tribulations, by anointing you with the oil of joy, as he says in Psalm 45:7. He says, I want to put joy in your heart. Right now at this time, that thing that is depressing you, surrender to Jesus. It's no accident that you tuned in. Surrender to him. Lay it down before the altar at this particular moment and watch him do exceedingly beyond what you can ask or think. What he's calling us to do at this moment is to be fully persuaded that he's able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond we can even ask or think, because he is God. A God who so loved this world that he sent his only begotten Son for you and for me. And whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Let's stop for a moment. Think what it means to believe. It comes from the Greek word pisteo. It means to adhere to cling to, and to trust in God totally, to be fully persuaded. It means to hang on in spite of the obstacles, because you're fully persuaded that your daddy's going to take care of you. You got as much faith as a bird does, maybe more, right? And you know that daddy, your heavenly father, is going to take care of you because he is faithful. Oh, I thank you, Lord, that with all the things that are so heavy on my heart at this moment, I can be fully persuaded, because faith comes where? From the word of faith comes from hearing, and hearing from the word of God. So as I go through the trials and I go through the tribulations, I must continue to get into God's word. I've got to read God's word. I've got to let God's word wrap its arms around me and strengthen me at this particular moment, that I may be fully persuaded that, yes, he's able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond what he can even ask or think. When I move into a state of prayer and I hear the wind blowing, I'm reminded of God's power and presence. It's in the wind. Even here, even in the midst of, when I'm alone with the Lord, I can hear him say, be still and know that I am God. I can hear him declaring in the midst of my doubts and uncertainties, as he does in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. You know, prayer makes me a better prayer warrior, a better listener, when I begin to respond to the hurts and needs of the poor, the fatherless, the widowed, the hurting, and the homeless. If this has just become, our religion just becomes a self-centered, self-serving thing, which Jesus Christ totally detested and confronted the scribes and Pharisees consistently over. Even identifying with homeless people in Matthew 8:20, he said, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head. And in Matthew chapter 25, he says, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, you visit me? A stranger, did you welcome me? As oft you've done to the least of these, even so you've done unto me. When we're fully persuaded that God is in his heavens, and God is here in our midst, and he's in all places, we're fully persuaded that God has spoken to us, then we aren't going to be able to just make excuses when we see other people hurting out there. We're not going to be like the rest of society, just laughing at them and just kind of getting caught up in the possession of things and are part of this wicked system of the world in which we live in. It happens. During the late 1800s and the colonialization that was taking place by much of Europe, they referred to it as a white man's burden as they went into Africa and took people's homes and colonies that took place. In America, it was manifest destiny as they took the land of the Indian. Today, it's referred to as gentrification. Rich folks moving in, those little white folks moving in to neighborhoods saying that they can do so much better for the folks and raising the rents to the extent that people can no longer afford there, shutting down homeless shelters, such as you see in the city of St. Louis, where they did almost all kinds of tax abatements and everything else they want to do just to get Amazon in there, knowing that everybody's rent would double. We're concerned about people over profits. We're fully persuaded, I'm saying all this to you, that it changes our whole world view and the way we approach things. We march to a different drumbeat because we're more concerned about being obedient to Him, the maker, of creator of heaven and earth, than we are about the what everybody else thinks. What everybody else thinks. So if it's socially acceptable in the social circles you may be in, you may need to get in different social circles, find a good church and be surrounded by Christians. But if you're around people and they make a joke about somebody because of a particular race or religion or nationality or the way they look or something like that, don't laugh with the rest of the crowd. You're fully persuaded that God doesn't want you to act that way. And when everybody else says, let's do it this way, and you know that's not the way it should be because the Spirit is speaking to your heart, you're fully persuaded and have enough courage as you're anchored in the Lord to say, no, thus saith the Lord. I'm going to do what God has called me to do. So as we take another look at Abraham, who stood up, so to speak, against the unbelief and the doubt, journeyed into a foreign country, we continue to see in Romans chapter 4, 18 to 22, that against all hope, Abraham's hope, Abraham and hope believed and so became the father of many nations. Just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead since he was about 100 years old and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver in unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had the power to do what he had promised. And this is why it was credited to him as righteousness. He was fully persuaded. Now, maybe God hasn't called you to have a child at 90, but He may be calling you to do something else. And you need to be fully persuaded. Get into God's Word. Believe that God has indeed created the heavens and the earth. Believe that He is true to His Word, that He will never leave you nor forsake you. And as you believe, continue to trust Him and watch Him do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. Father, I come to you with my brothers and my sisters. And Lord, sometimes the things you lay on our hearts seem so impossible, but you're a God that deals with the impossible. And Lord, we thank you that we can be fully persuaded to the extent that you even sent your Son into this world. And he took our sins upon himself and he died on that cross and he rose from the dead. Over 500 people saw him as he's resurrected. Lord God, we thank you for your word, the reality of the resurrection, the power of the Holy Spirit, and the wonders of creation. Now, Lord, we want to move forth fully persuaded that you're able to do what you have promised. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.
You feeling lonely, fearful, depressed, discouraged? Then call the Dial a Message at this time. 314-241-7000. That's 314-241-7000. A special message just for you. 314-241-7000.